How's everybody feeling? Sleep. Okay, that was so delayed. Good morning. What a great day it is to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I hope after being here today, we will be able to receive that fresh wind from God after experiencing that heat wave. I'm so glad everybody made it through that this week safely. And also, today is a very special day. If you did not know, it is Grandparents' Day. So happy Grandparents' Day to all the grandparents here. Raise your hand if you're a grandparent. If you're on Zoom, you can put it in the chat. If you're a grandparent, we thank you all for the role that you play in our lives and for the support that you provide to your grandchildren. Please stand with me as we go to our Lord in prayer, and Nyasha will be leading us in prayer today.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for a brand new day that we get to come together and to fellowship and worship in your name. And thank you that we made it through the previous heat wave safely. Lord, I pray that our minds and hearts will be prepared to receive a fresh wind from you during the service. During this worship time, may we be able to give our burdens up to you. We give you all the glory and praise. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Good morning, South Bay. Good morning, good morning to all of our grandparents. Raise your hand one more time. God bless you. Happy Grandparents' Day to all of you that are here this morning. Are you ready to worship the Lord this morning? Those of you on Zoom, we're going to do this song. We know that you know it. It simply says, "Oh Lord, we praise you." Anybody got praise for God this morning, for his faithfulness, for all that he's done? If not that, just because of who he is. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together right here. Let's celebrate him together. I invite you to sing to an audience of one this morning. Let's celebrate the Lord. Come on, sing. Oh Lord.
Oh Lord, we praise you.
He took away my frown and all those things that had me bound. I thought about all those times when I was walking around in a daze. But today I stand before you with nothing but praise. Oh Lord,
oh Lord,
we praise you.
We praise.
Took away my crown and all those things that had me bound. I thought about all those times when I was walking around in a daze. But today I stand before you with nothing but praise. Oh Lord,
oh Lord,
we praise you.
We praise you.
We come to give you glory.
Oh Lord,
we praise you.
We praise you.
Everything in us gives you praise.
Oh Lord, we praise you.
We praise you. Yes, we do, Lord.
We
Celebrate him this morning. The Bible says to let everything that has breath give praise to God. Let everything that has breath give praise to God. And all it takes is just a moment to think back on who he is and all that he's done, and praise is a natural response to a God who loves us unconditionally. He is our Alpha and he is our Omega. Let's sing it together. Just meditate on God this morning. Where would I be? praise. Come on, one more time. Let's tell them together, we give you all.
We give you all the glory. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised.
Come on, give him your worship this morning just for a few minutes. We honor you this morning, God. You are our Alpha and our Omega. We bless and worship you this morning, God. We open up our hearts to you this morning. Where would we be without your grace, oh God? Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for being a consistent God. We give you worship this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, just continue to give him worship in your own way this morning. I'm not sure what you want to say to the king, but this is your time to be with your Savior this morning and tell him, thank you for what you've done in my life. Thank you for keeping me. Thank you for watching over me. Thank you for keeping my family. Thank you for letting me wake up this morning and see another day. We give you glory. You deserve the honor. You deserve the praise. You are Alpha and you are Omega. Hallelujah. And you're the God of the in-between. And we bless you this morning. And we give you all the glory, God. We give you all the glory, Jesus. And we worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Elder Daniel's going to come and lead us to the throne of grace. Hallelujah.
Good morning, family. Happy Grandparents' Day. And just in case you've forgotten, it's such a beautiful day outside that this is 9/11. September 20, 2001. We want to take a minute to just pause and pray for God's grace, mercy, and peace. So just take 1 minute and just allow God to hear your voice.
Yes. Lord, thank you this
Lord God, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you, O Lord God, for allowing us to come together to call your name. We praise you, O Lord God. We praise you for your goodness, and we praise you for your kindness. Thank you, O Lord God. Thank you. Lord God, we pray that you will continue to keep us and bless us and strengthen us where we need to be strengthened. We pray, O Lord God, for the blessing that you bless this house, O Lord God. We bless the leadership here, O Lord God. We pray that when things happen that some people don't know where to turn, but you are God and you still sit on the throne of life. You are the same God that woke us up yesterday, that will wake us up tomorrow. And we praise and we humble and we give you glory. Lord God, we pray that people will learn to hold on until you answer their prayers. Those that are sick, those that are worried, those that don't know which way to turn, but hold on, God is coming. We pray that you will enlighten them and be with them. And we thank you and we honor you, O Lord God. We have brought us a mighty long way and we have a long ways to come. But we stand on your word that you will truly be true to your weak and humble servants. If you bow your knees and just ask, it will be granted. And we thank you and we praise you and we give you the glory. For you are truly a God of the truth, and you still sit on the throne of life. And we thank you and we give you the glory, O Lord God. I don't think sometimes we understand who you are and the power that you have. Nothing happens without your approval. Nothing, the sun doesn't set unless you give the okay. And life does not continue unless you give its blessings. But we thank you and we praise you. And we ask that you bless this service. We ask that you bless the speaker. We ask that you bless this house. And we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come on, celebrate the Lord as you take your seats. Miss Ash is going to come and lead us further.
Amen. Our Lord, our God, is worthy to be praised. Amen. And we are going to give him all the praise that we have, no matter what our circumstances look like. Good morning and welcome, South Bay family and friends here in the sanctuary and on Zoom. At this time, I would like to welcome any guests that we have here in the sanctuary. If you are a guest, can you please raise your hand? Any guests? No? And if we have any guests on Zoom, I would like to encourage you to visit our website at sobcc.org. Click on the button that says I'm new, fill out the form, and we will be sure to have a staff member that will be in contact with you. And it is now time to transition to our time of fellowship. If you are on Zoom, you will be sent to your breakout rooms. And here in the sanctuary, a reminder, if you have a green dot, that means they are open to be hugged, shake hands, smile, everything, all of the above. Thank you.
We want to be intentional about honoring God's faithfulness to us. Also at this time, we want to give you the opportunity to give your tithes and offerings. You can give us on our SBCC app or online at our website, or use the envelopes in the seat pockets in front of you that are here in the sanctuary. We'll give you a few moments to give while our band plays for a few moments.
It's gonna be okay.
But everything is going wrong and we don't know what to do.
And nobody cares enough to help us.
You know me and Grandpa care.
We know.
I don't think you do.
Maybe we should tell them in a way they'll definitely understand. Drop that beat.
Where is that music coming from?
Hey, everybody! It's Grandmaster Grandma coming at you. And this is my boy,
the Notorious P.O.P.
What is this? I think they're about to rap.
Yo, check it out! They call me Grandma.
Grandma!
Granny!
Granny!
Mimi and Madea. We all know why I'm your favorite. The reason's very clear.
Can I have soda?
Yes.
Candy?
Yeah, baby.
Ice cream treats?
When my babies come to Grandma's house, they can't have anything. So give me hugs and give me kisses. Eat another ice cream cone, cause after I sugar you up.
Ooh, child, I'm gonna send your tail back home.
My hip may slip, I may walk slow. My back is out of whack. But you best believe no matter what, your grandma's got your back.
Well, that was awkward.
You ain't seen nothing yet. Come on, Pop, show them what you're working with.
Oh, y'all done woke me up now. They call me Grandpa.
Grandpa!
Papa. And some just call me Pop.
Pop.
And when I step into the room, the party never stops. Cause I have jokes and funny faces. Yeah, I'm a comedian.
slow, my back gets out of whack.
Oh, my back.
But you best believe no matter what, your grandpa's got your back.
I did not see that coming.
Me neither, but it's good to know that you have our back. And you know what?
No, what?
We've got your back too.
Your hip may slip, you may walk slow, your back gets out of whack. But you best believe no matter what, your grands have got your back.
Aw, that's so sweet. Now who wants some ice cream?
I do!
Come on, babies.
I think I'll have a scoop too.
All right now.
To all the grandparents out there,
thanks for having our backs.
And to our grandparents,
we love you!
Aw, thank you guys so much. Come and give Grandma a big hug. Grandma's baby's so sweet.
Aw, that's so nice of you. Grandpa loves you too.
Oh, that is so nice of you guys. Thank you. You know we love you.
Oh, that's great. Is it time for my solo?
That was just a small tribute that we wanted to do again to all of our grandparents that are here this morning. One more time, can you just wave your hand if you're a grandparent? We just want to celebrate and thank God for you today. Could you relate to that video at all? I saw Miss Louise when he said, you can come over to my house and get anything. She said, that's right. But we honor you in a special way this morning. And we have a small video tribute that we want to play for all of you this morning just to give you honor and to celebrate you this day.
Waking up, thanking God. Every day is feeling just like Sunday. Wifey fly by my side. Green light, everything is going my way. Riding clean, living dreams. Just left the barber and I'm feeling like Midas. Heard him say, give him praise. What's in the water got you acting like this? Ain't a day gone by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, I'm close and I tell you what's up. Listen. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed, yes. Living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, ask me how I'm doing. I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes. Playing cards, laughing hard, barbecuing, waking up the whole block. Music loud, turning out. Little kids are breaking out the bus stop. Life is good. Really good, and every moment, no, I can't forget. I gotta say, I won't change. You're the reason that I am like this. Ain't a day gone by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, come close and I'll tell you what's up. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed, yes. Living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, ask me how I'm doing. I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed.
Family and
your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. Children, may his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and the children and the children. May his praise, may he give, may his favor be upon you and your children and their children.
So I'm not sure if you could hear the scripture that was being sung in that last song. It's number 624 through 26, and it's a prayer, and we pray this over all of our grandparents. It says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift you up in his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Can we have all of our grandparents please stand? And do me a favor, just look around the room and tell your neighbor, say, Happy Grandparents Day. If you would bow your heads, let me pray for you. Lord Jesus, look with love on grandparents the world over. Protect them. They are a source of enrichment for families, for the church, and for all of society. Support them. As they grow older, may they continue to be for their families strong pillars of gospel faith, guardians of noble domestic ideals, living treasuries of sound religious traditions. Make them teachers of wisdom and courage, and they may pass on to future generations the fruits of their mature human and spiritual experience. Lord Jesus, help families and society to value the presence and role of grandparents. May they never be ignored or excluded, but always encounter respect and love. Help them to live serenely and to feel welcomed in all the years of life which you give them. God of heaven, bless the living. Keep grandparents constantly in your care. Accompany them on their earthly pilgrimage, and by your prayers, grant that all families may one day, Father, support, love, celebrate every grandparent in every home. God, we love you this morning, and specifically for the grandparents here at the South Bay Community Church, we pray your abundant blessings. Lord, bless them and keep them. May your face shine upon them, and God, for all the days of their life, may you give them peace. We pray this and we thank you in advance in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. And amen. God bless you. We are in for a treat this morning. Our own Pastor Emeritus, Dr. Stanley Long, is bringing our message. Can we welcome him as he comes this morning?
Well, I want to say that you are the best looking grand folks I've ever seen in my life. I mean, I was looking, you look so young and vibrant and alive. And I thought, boy, it would have been great to have a sermon on grandparenting to go along with the day. But I didn't make the choice today. I'm not the pastor here. I do what I'm told like everybody else. So I'll be preaching about something else. But before I begin, I do think we ought to acknowledge the the incredible contribution of our band. These folks are tremendous. Thank you. Thank you. Just super. You make grandparents pat their toe. That's right. Great. Great job. Super. Thanks. Father, we pray that in these few moments that we spend around your word, that you would give us insight and wisdom, guidance and direction, and that you would speak to our hearts. Help us to hear what it is that you want to say to us. And let Jesus Christ be praised. It's in his name we pray. And all of God's people said amen. Last week, Pastor Tammy began or introduced us to a new sermon series entitled Life Reimagined. And among the many insights that she shared was the idea that God, from the beginning of human existence, wanted us humans on this planet to be stewards. She then gave us a new definition of stewardship. And she gave us that definition so that it would broaden our thinking and release our capacity to the old thinking that we have when we hear the word stewardship, and to enable us to kind of envision what a reimagined life could look like. She shared in that new definition these words: stewardship is trusting in the promises of God to deploy the resources of God to accomplish the mission of God for the glory of God. My task was to unpack the first segment of this definition and to wrestle with the implications of what does trusting in the promises of God look like. Struggling with the promises of God is not unique to 21st century Christians. In fact, learning how to work with God's promise was a challenge that the early Christians dealt with as well. They often found themselves in situations of oppression, persecution, rejection, suffering. During immense persecution was when Peter wrote what I'm about to share with you. For he was about to be executed when he penned the words of 2 Peter. And he wrote these words to Christians like you and me who were going through very difficult times. He wrote, "His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires." If I'm reading this text correctly, Peter is saying that the promises of God are supposed to do something. The promises of God are supposed to cause something to happen to us through them. Through the promises of God, the character of God is to be produced in us. Now, that's an incredible thought when you think of it. For Peter is saying that the promises of God is to be the instrument that produces the character of God, divine power working in us, he said, producing a divine nature. So that makes promises a very big deal, which causes me to begin by asking the question, well, what is a promise? What is a promise? Have you ever had someone promise you something and didn't follow through? Sometimes it could be a big promise, sometimes it could be a small promise, but when somebody breaks a promise, it does something to us. When somebody breaks a promise, it has a way of making its way through our emotions, into our heart and in our minds. When someone makes a promise and breaks it, we feel angry. We feel disappointed. We feel not respected. And this is an incredible power to place in words, isn't it? It's because a promise is not just empty words out of a person's mouth. It's not just meaningless text on a sheet of paper. A promise is a commitment. And a commitment is something that we take very seriously. When someone makes a commitment to us, we expect them to keep that commitment. When we make a promise, we have to rearrange our schedules. We sometimes have to make other changes in opportunities that may come our way. Promises causes us to change our behavior because now we've made a commitment that we must live up to. The message of a promise is an affirmation of love. When someone makes a promise to us, it's because they are demonstrating respect for us, friendship for us, a connection with us. A promise says that you care about me. So then if we take the realities of promises and we move them over to the Bible and God, it starts to raise some additional questions because God's made some promises. And probably the first question we might want to ask is, are all the promises in the Bible for me? Are all the promises that God has made, is that something that God has to live up to? When I was a young student in Bible school, I remember one of the courses that they taught us in Bible school. It was very cute, very easy to remember. It went like this. Every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line. All the blessings of his love divine. Every promise in the book is mine. It sounds cute. It's just not true. Every promise in the book is not mine. Every promise in the book has not been made to me. In fact, one of the problems in the Christian church is some of the worst theology you'll ever hear is in our music. We sing songs that paint God in all kinds of ways. It's just not true. We say God will do all kinds of things. It's just not true. Songwriters don't always get it right. And what makes it tragic is that we sing those songs and we embrace those songs as though they were straight from the throne of God. And the fact of the matter is, they aren't. Amen. Amen. Just like so many of the promises in Scripture are not for us. Some of those promises are made to individuals. Some of those promises are made to nations. Some of the promises are made to certain situations. And if we don't get the promise right, then our expectation from God isn't right. And when God doesn't come through on a promise that he never made, then it affects the relationship that we have with God and makes us afraid to trust Him. The way to determine if a promise is for us is to apply the exact same process that we should be applying as we interpret any scripture in the Bible. When you read the scriptures in the Bible, you have to remember that the Bible was not written to you. In fact, the Bible tells you very clearly who it was written to. Paul says, this is a letter to the church at Rome. This is a letter to the church in Colossae. This is a letter to the people of Philippi. And they tell you very precisely who it was written to. It wasn't written to you. It was written for you. It's been preserved for you. But it wasn't written to you. And some of us, when we begin to read the scriptures, we treat the scriptures as though it was written right to me. Well, you can't read it as though it was written right to you, because it wasn't written to you. It was written to someone else. Which means then that when I read the Bible, I have to take the time to understand what did the people who it was written to understand the Bible to be saying. In other words, what did the first hearers of those words hear? What did the first hearers understand that what was being said to them? You see, because if we don't understand what it was saying to them, we will make it say something to us that it was never saying. And when we make it say something to us that it was never saying, then we put words in God's mouth that He never said. So the first thing we must do when we interpret scripture is to take the time to ask, what did the first hearers hear? Then we ask the second question is, what did the original hearers understand that to mean for them to do? And then the third thing we ask is, what is there in what they understood that applies to me in the time and the culture and the environment that I find myself in today? What is there for me today? In other words, I need to separate what was said to them in their culture to what is being said to me in my culture. If you get that, say amen. Amen. I have a very simple illustration that makes the point. In Romans chapter 16, in verse 16, Paul says this, greet one another with a holy kiss. Very simple. Greet one another with a holy kiss. Now the question is, what part of that statement should we be applying to ourselves? Now here's the thing with the Bible and the Word of God. If the truth of God is not true for every culture, at every time, in every place in history, in every situation, then it can't be God's word to us. Now, do I need to repeat that? You got that. Say amen if you got that. Amen. If it doesn't fit every culture, every situation, at every time in history, it can't be God's word to us. So when I say, Paul says, greet one another with a holy kiss. Well, a holy kiss can't be the issue, because every culture don't kiss. Some men or some cultures don't want men kissing men. Some cultures don't want people touching them with their mouth. So the issue can't be the kiss. The issue has to be something more than the kiss. What's the issue? The greeting. The greeting is the issue. So when I read the text, the thing that fits every culture, every situation, every person in the world, every place in the world, every time in history, Paul says, whoever you are, greet one another. Greet one another. So I may not greet you with a kiss. I don't greet people with a kiss. I don't do that. In fact, most of you don't do that. We don't greet people with a kiss in this country, but you go over in the Middle East and you'll find that they greet people with a kiss. So that means that my scripture just disappeared. Okay, I got it. So that means that the real issue of the text is not the kiss, but it's the way we greet one another. And that applies to every time in history, every place in the world. So then when it comes to the promises of God, I'm looking at the promises of God through the same process that I look at how I interpret the Word of God. How do I understand the promises of God that are for me? How do I determine which promise of God is for me and which promise of God is not for me? Well, the first thing I think we need to do to be able to make the most of the promises of God is that we first got to understand the promises of God. We got to know them. You can't use the promises of God if you don't know them. Amen. I can't stand on the promises of God if I don't know them. I can't be transformed by the promises of God if I don't know them. So the very beginning, when I said that Peter said that the promises of God are to make the character of God work in us, can't do that if I don't know them. And so at least I've got to know what the promises of God in order to be able to embrace them, to be able to celebrate them with certainty. And the Bible's got some incredible, wonderful promises for us if we know them. For example, the Bible promises that God will give us wisdom if we ask. The Bible promises that God will provide a way out of our temptation. The Bible promises that our salvation is secure in Jesus Christ no matter what. The Bible promises that God will never leave us or forsake us. In fact, if you want to do a great Bible study, look up the promises of God that include the word never, where God says, I will never do something. Here he says, I will never leave you or forsake you. The promises of God says that God will finish the work that he has begun in us. Wonderful promise. He promises that he's coming back for us, that he's not going to just leave us, but he's going to return for us. And do you notice anything special about the promises of God to those few that I just mentioned? Do you notice how much they say more about who God is and less about our circumstance? That it highlights more God's activity in our lives than about the circumstances that we're in? That it points out that the promises of God are the anchor of our soul regardless to the circumstances around us? So the first thing we must do to be able to store to the benefit from the promises of God is we got to know them. The second thing that we have to do is that we have to make sure we don't misuse them. We misuse the promises of God when we don't appropriately apply them. For example, we misuse the promises of God when we confuse the principles of God with the promises of God. God in his genius has given us, preserved the scriptures for us, and he's preserved them in all different kinds of ways. We have narratives that tell his story. We have proverbs that tell his principles. We have poetry in which tells his story. We have the epistles that tell his story. We have all different kinds of ways in which God is communicating his story. But if we don't get it right, then we make God say what he didn't say. Principles state great truths, great general truths. but they're not promises. And one of the famous ones would be the one that we were taught when we were children. We've heard over and over again, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he's old, he won't depart. But that's not a promise. That's a principle. You know it's not a promise by looking at some of our kids. We know that that didn't happen. See, and then when we try to make God's principles, God's promises, we get in trouble. Because it looks like God failed us. And then we beat ourselves up and say, what did I do wrong? Because it didn't happen like God promised. He didn't promise that. And so we misuse God's promises when we mess up the principles and the promises. Or another might be we misuse God's promises when we ignore the if before the promise. There are promises that God made where he just stuck that little word in there. If you do so and so, this will be the outcome. If you obey, this will be the outcome. And sometimes we want the promise that says what will be the outcome, and we want to ignore the if on the front part. And that would be to misuse God's promise. You can't get by the if, because the promise is only legitimate if we obey the if to get the rest of it. Are you still with me? Say amen. Amen. We misuse God's promises if we claim them, in an attempt to force God to do something that we know God doesn't want us to do. We misuse it when we try to manipulate God. We know that God's already said, don't do so and so, but we want to do it. And so we tell God a promise that he made, as though he forgot. And then when he doesn't do it, our hearts we sink with distrust because God didn't fulfill his promise. Well, the promises of God are not something that we take and use to fit whatever way we want. You know, you can't play with God like that. I mean, God will not be tricked into doing something. And just quoting his promises back to him, it's not like he forgot his promises. He knows what promises he made. I mean, he is God. He sees tomorrow, yesterday, and all that. We can't fool God by trying to create some way in which we can make the promise work. It doesn't work if that was never his intention in the first place. A misuse of God's promises caused them not to work. Which means that the only way we can then steward the promises of God is to trust them. To trust them. Promises are only as good as the person who makes them. And one of the great realities about God is he is trustworthy. So when you lean on the promises of God, when you count on the promises of God, you can do so because God sticks to his word. He keeps the promises he made because he's God. Amen. God cannot lie. His character will not permit him to lie. And so when God makes a promise, he will keep the promise because he is true. God is eternal, so he cannot forget. God is faithful, so he doesn't change his mind. God is all powerful, so he has the ability to carry out his promises. So you can trust in the promises of God. But you do have to activate them. You remember that credit card you have when you got a new one? And it said, this card must be activated before you can use it. It gave you a phone number to call or an email address to write. But before that powerful card that could purchase almost anything could be used, it has to be activated. That's the same way it is with the promises of God. The promises of God are there, but they have to be activated. We have to act on them as life deals us different hands that we have to deal with. We must act on the promises of God. When we find ourselves in situations where our knees are shaking and our hearts are beating with anxiety, it's the acting on the promises of God that causes the power of God to work within us. We don't choose what happens to us in life. We do choose how we respond to what happens to us in life. And to have a life that is reimagined is to be able to activate the promises of God to do what God has said he would do for us. You see, to trust in God isn't an attitude. It's an action. To trust in God is a decision. It's a choice. It's a step. It's a step whereby we activate what it is that God has promised us. A very simple illustration, and I'm about finished here, is the one where Jesus talks to us in Matthew 17, and he says to us this. He says, I tell you the truth. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. This is a moving mountain promise. That when you are facing the mountains of life, and every single one of us will face those kind of difficulties. Jesus says you can move that impossible mountain. But there are two things that are required to do that. The first is I've got to think bigger. Think bigger. Notice what Jesus says. He says, nothing will be impossible. Think bigger. Whatever difficulty you're dealing with this morning, no matter how big it is, think bigger. God is bigger than that. God is greater than that. God is stronger than that. God is more powerful than that. Think bigger. And then Jesus says the second thing is to start smaller. Start smaller? He says, if you have faith like a mustard seed, you know how small a mustard seed is? Jesus says, if you start with just a little faith, you can say to this mountain, be moved and planted in the sea. Jesus says, you can do it. Now, I hear people sometimes say to me, well, I guess I just don't have enough faith. No, it isn't the faith that moves the mountain. It's God that moves the mountain. Amen. Amen. And God is big enough to move any situation that we find ourselves in. Amen. The question isn't how big is your faith? The question is how big is your God? Amen. And Jesus says that if you will trust his promise, you can move from your life the most difficult situation that you find yourselves in. I said to the folks last night, when you get to this part of the sermon, this is where you say, turn to page number 568 in your hymn book, and let's stand together and sing. What? Nah. No. Standing on the promises. Standing on the promises. This is the part where you get to the point where you've listened to all the things that I shouldn't do, I've learned how I should interpret scripture. I know that there are some promises for me. I know what those promises are. What do I do now? I stand on the promises. I put my life on the word of God. I trust in what it is that he has said he will do. Unfortunately, we don't sing the hymns anymore. But there's some powerful words in those hymns that we ought to remember. Standing on the promises of Christ my King through eternal ages, let his praises ring, glory in the highest. I will shout and sing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assails, amen, by the living word of God, I shall prevail, because I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, because I'm standing on the promises of God. When I was working on this message, I kept asking God and myself, Lord, you know, there are other ways to treat this thing about trusting God's promises. But I kept coming back to this. If I don't understand how God functions, how can I trust him? Amen. If I don't understand God's promises, how can I stand on them? If I don't understand God's promises, I will make him say things he didn't say, and that will disappoint me. And when I'm disappointed, I won't trust. Amen. I need to learn how to stand on the promises of God. Amen. Father, I pray today that you would help us to get a hold of your truth, to understand what it is that you have said, and to rest in your love and wisdom. In the powerful name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Dr. Long, on giving us that wonderful message on stewarding the promises of God. At this time, I would like to introduce our highlights for the week. We have some amazing things going on here at South Bay, so please pay attention to the screen as we will have our highlight video.
Hey family, these are your highlights and announcements for the week. As Pastor Tammy recently announced, it's SBCC's turn to host the Safe Parking Initiative here at the church. To make our hospitality a success, we need your help. We have several roles where we're looking for volunteers, including providing and serving breakfast on Saturday mornings, adopt a car, and purchasing gift cards that guests can use to buy lunch or dinner. You can find more information and the chance to sign up on the events page on the church website. Let's use this time to be fruitful to God and show limitless love to those in need. The new quarter for the Adult Christian Formation started today, and it's not too late to participate. ACF is your chance to connect with God and grow together through Bible study and fellowship with your SBCC family. Moderated by various church members, including Maurice and Debbie Smallwood, Pastor Stan Long, Reverend Harry Cox, and more. Visit the ACF page on the SBCC website to learn more. As we expand various ministries within the church, we can't neglect the body, mind, and spirit. The Body, Mind, and Spirit, BMS ministry, addresses the whole person through exercise, mental wellness, nutrition, and spiritual awareness. Your wellness journey is essential, so you'll have access to educational materials, articles, resources, and periodically live events to help you increase your impact on the world, the community, and your family through ministry. Learn more about the purpose of this new ministry on our webpage at sobcc.org/BMS. These are your highlights for the week.
And we will have Dr. Long that will be giving our benediction to close us out.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow, like you did last Sunday. But I want to tell you a story first. I was at a convention in Chicago, and I was the moderator of the convention and the service. And so it came time for the offering, and I said, let's begin by singing Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. And the brother on the organ, he leaned over and said, I don't know that song, Pastor. I never heard that before. And I realized at that point, I'm a whole new generation that's grown up and don't know Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Do you know that song, brother? All right, good. All right, let's sing it together.